bred confusion, my illusion is serene. Behind the screen, am I a king or am I a queen? I'm such a tease, fellas like these, trying to please, get ill at ease, not sure if he Louis or Louise.
For a long while, it was over my dead body. I'll never, you know, go through that again. 5 continuous years on Broadway, just about. I mean, to this day, she still has nightmares.
Julie did start in the theater. She did start with an audience in front of her. So that's going to come back.
The demonstration that we gave at the Waldorf showed us what we had, and what we had was not good enough, we realized, so we upped it a little bit, and then we got into rehearsals, and then we upped it a little bit more, and that's, I suppose, the nature of a Broadway show.
However wonderful she might have been in whatever movie, the rarest and most ultimate magic was in live performances, and so it's really genuinely thrilling to me that she's back.
I think she waited until the kids were grown and she'd done what she needed to do and the family was taken care of and she was free to really give herself completely to it, because she's not one to do anything halfway.
It's a little like Cassius Clay coming back, you know, or Joe Louis after they've won the championship. She left here on top of the world, you know, and to go back and take that big chance, you know, I can see how intimidated she'd be.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have great pleasure in introducing to you our youngest soprano from Starlight Roof, Julie Andrews. Well, Julie, is this the first time you've ever made a gramophone record?
Oh, yes. Is it your first record, too?
No. How old are you?
I am 12. How old are you?
My mother and father divorced when I was quite young. So, from a very early age, I actually remember just commuting between the two families. My mother remarried, my father remarried, both had children. But my mother's second husband was Ted Andrews, and he had a wonderful tenor voice, and my mother, who was a fine pianist, joined with him, and they became a vaudeville team.
Ted was a big, bluff Canadian, and Barbara was a beautiful singer, who was also a very fine musician, and it was she who really taught Julie the principles of show business, and they used to drag poor Julie around with them, and she didn't like doing it.
My stepfather decided to give me some singing lessons. I think it was in an effort to get close to me, to make friends. I don't know. He had no idea that I had any kind of a voice, but suddenly he just said, well, let's see, you know, I'll teach her to sing and we'll have some quality time together, so to speak. And to his surprise and all of our surprise, I had this freak adult voice in a very little girl.
Julie joined the act, and initially, as far as I remember, although I didn't see this, I believe would stand on a box or soapbox or something to get up to Ted's height, and they would sing duets together.
The fiddles are playing a tune that you know. Hey-ho, come to the fair, the drums are all beating.
And then gradually, as in some sort of terrible B-movie, it changed from Ted and Barbara Andrews with Julie to Julie Andrews with Ted and Barbara.
So it comes then, maidens and men to the fair in the pride of the morning.
I first met Julie in 1947. We were in a show called Starlight Roof, which starred Vic Oliver and other luminaries. She was a child of 11, very solemn, very large eyes, enchanting, and we were both terrified. And we both used to shake before going on stage. And as soon as we were on, the shaking stopped, and boom, we were into it, you know.
I first saw Julie many years before we met. She'd made quite a big splurge. There was quite a lot of publicity about this child with a phenomenal voice. And my mother said, this you have to see.
I followed an act done by a wonderful man called Wally Bogue.
And Wally used to do balloon sculpture, you know, blow up the balloons and then tie them all together and make animals. And an absolute tremendous hit.
At the end of his act, when he had all these wonderful animals, giraffes and dogs and poodles and things like that around, he asked if there was any little girl or boy in the audience who would like to come up and get one of these.
And I always remember this tiny, bony little thing suddenly said, "I'm coming, I'm coming," and she ran up on stage.
And then the man who really was the star of the show was also on stage and would talk to me and say, "What do you do?" "Well, I sing, you know, would you like to sing for us tonight?" "Sure."
"What are you going to sing for us?"
"I'd like to sing the Polonaise from Nîmes."
"Oh, lovely. Just the kind of junk I like."
And she used to stop the show every night. She stopped it the first night, and from then on she took all the notices.
I think the amazing thing about Julie's voice was the clarity, the purity, and the range of it.
First actually laid eyes on Julie in the flesh as opposed to in photographs. I think she was about 11 and I was 12.
Tony saw me in a production of Humpty Dumpty, I think, when I played the egg.
And when the egg fell from the wall, there was this enchanting little gal with some kind of chocolate makeup all over her egg, over her legs, which I found extremely seductive.
And he happened to be on the train going home to our hometown.
And then when we all got out at the station at Walton on Thames, I asked where she lived, and she said the other side of the tracks.
And the next thing I knew, Tony and his brother were around at the house, and they found out where I lived, and Tony began to write from college, and he wrote such sweet and lovely letters with wonderful drawings in them, and as you well know, he's now one of the leading designers on Broadway and in film. And he did little drawings of a book that he was doing. Eventually we became boyfriend and girlfriend and went through our teens together.
She was quite often out on tour in what is here called vaudeville, but in England it was the music hall shows, and she would be in variety shows called things like Bells on Their Toes, B-E-L-L-E-S.
In music hall, you only did it for 1 week here or 1 week there, so you spent your life on a train.
So I toured and toured England many times and belted out my bastardized versions of operatic arias, and my mother accompanied the piano, but eventually I went out on my own, and they were good learning years, but they were tough and difficult.
They were a very mixed bag, these shows. Sometimes they were sort of accidentally wonderful, and sometimes they were almost heartbreaking.
Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to say thank you so very much for the kind way you've listened to poor little me.
It's only in retrospect that one realizes one was ever unhappy or uncomfortable or whatever. But actually, the ability to be a breadwinner and things like that came pretty naturally. I mean, we needed money, and I was able to manage it, and it kept us going.
Ted and Barbara were so used to being a big, popular act and with substantial earnings that when it reversed and Julie became the breadwinner, that was a tough passage for them. I remember she used to keep a journal, and this was a time when things were particularly rough at home, and her stepdad was going through some drinking problems and would have a tendency to break up the house now and then. And In her journals, she would refer to this as the most perfect and magical home and how lucky she was.
I never thought in the old days that my early days in vaudeville would be of any use to me at all. And yet here in Victor Victoria and many, many other times as well, some of the humor, some of the comedy, whatever you do, you store away somewhere and it's used.
Tomorrow comes with no guarantee. We need each other for company.
I did tour long enough and visit enough theaters that I really got a taste of vaudeville, what it was like and its glory days. I was able to observe so many wonderful comedians, wonderful performers, wonderful acrobatic acts and juggling acts and things like that. I was able to see a lady called Ella Shields, and she did a wonderful song called Burlington Bertie, which I subsequently did in the film Star.
The Prince of Wales' brother, along with some other, slaps me on the back and says, come and see mother. I'm Bertie, Bertie, and royalty's hurt. When they ask me to dine, I say no. I just had a banana with Lady Diana. I'm Burlington Bertie. Burlington Bertie. I'm Burlington Bertie.
Who knows, she could have been the lady that set me on the road to Victor Victoria.
You're on your own, kid. What?
Oh.
Your turn.
Ruby Killer has my tap shoes.
What made you and me will stay together?
I was doing Cinderella in London, and a lady who was the director of a play called The Boyfriend came to see the show and asked if I would like to come to Broadway.
The Boyfriend opened over here at a tiny, tiny theater club, and it just took the fancy of people, the 1920s, the flapper period.
And they cast a new company to come to America. I said, oh, no, I couldn't possibly leave home, and my family needs me, and I kind of had become a little bit the family caretaker.
And she knocked on the door, opened the door, and there's Julie. And for a moment, I didn't recognize her with the light behind her, this beautiful girl. And she said, hello, Uncle Michael. She'd been crying.
She didn't want to do The Boyfriend because she realized she was going to have to be away from home for a serious chunk of time.
I'm off to America with Boyfriend. And I said, who is he? Thinking the swine taking this young child to America. She said, no, with The Boyfriend. It's the show. I said, oh, my God, yes. Well, why are you crying? It'll be a great success. Well, I'm frightened and I don't want to leave home.
My dear real father said, Julie, for God's sake, go. It could last 3 months, it could last 3 weeks. It will open up your head. Do it.
We've got to have, we've got to have, for it's so dreary not to have that certain thing called the boyfriend. We scheme about and dream about and we begin to scream about that certain thing called the boyfriend.
Dillislay was the first roommate I ever had, and it was the oddest but ultimately most satisfying coupling, because where I was absolutely painfully shy and wouldn't have dared venture out, she was this wonderful extrovert that wasn't frightened of anything.
She was a very private person, Julie, whereas I effervesced off in all directions, heaven knows what I used to say, and I don't think I went to bed for 4 months. Julie always did. She was very much more family-minded than me, I think. Her heart was always in England.
All we want is a room in Bloomsbury.
did about 2 weeks of previews, and each night I noticed that I would get a different reception. Some nights I guess I was over the top, some nights I didn't know what I was doing. Some nights I probably got it right unconsciously.
Truly was very used to standing up there, playing this perky little girl, playing herself. Suddenly, she's being asked to play a girl who is lost, who is lonely, who thinks nobody loves her for anything but her money, who falls in love. It's a lot, it's a long journey she was asked to make at the age of 18.
Cy Feuer, our producer, came to me the day that we opened, and he said, you know, you were awful last night, you were terrible. And I said, I know, what happened? And he said, everybody else is being funny, everybody else is being comedic. I want you to just be absolutely straight. Just stay inside your character and be that lady who loses her love and whose heart is breaking. Everything I did from the heart, and it did work, and to my total surprise, it sort of threw me up into some kind of stardom, because the notices were wonderful the next morning, and I thank Cy from the bottom of my heart.
When we took the curtain call, Julie'd suddenly gone, and the audience were calling for her. She was the great success of the evening. Polly Browne, Polly Browne, Polly Browne, they kept saying. And I had to race to the dressing room, and I grabbed her and said, come on, they're calling for you. Come back on stage.
She was extraordinarily shy, not only socially and life off stage, but of how little she knew of conventional acting techniques. She'd always just done it. She'd never really trained it. But at the moment that she got before an audience, she was home. That was what she knew.
I sang for Rodgers and Hammerstein for a show called Pipe Dream. I was just finishing The Boyfriend, about to go home after my year, and I sang for them, and when my aria was finished, Rodgers said, have you been auditioning or, you know, seeing anybody else? And I said, oh, yes, I've been auditioning for some gentlemen called Lerner and Lowe, and they're thinking of doing this musical version of Shaw's Pygmalion called My Fair Lady. And Rodgers paused for a moment, and then he said, I want to say something to you. If they ask you, I think you should do My Fair Lady. If they don't ask you, I'd like you to let me know, because we would like to also use you. But do My Fair Lady if they ask you. Sure that I understood Eliza, but I didn't. I was too shy and too gauche and too full of insecurities in those years to know whether anybody would know that I could. And Mosshart gave me such dignity and such great advice, and he really was very, very tough. You know, he closed the rehearsal process for about 48 hours, and we spent one very long weekend where he pushed and bullied and cajoled and showed me and was Eliza Doolittle sometimes, and then told me to stop acting like a girl guide and so on and so forth. He made me have a picture of what Eliza should be.
Who type would care of me and who would be lovely, lovely, lovely.
Wonderful, Julie. Absolutely perfect. Got the action wonderfully.
Oh, thank you. What about the orchestra? Aren't they marvelous?
Are they?
Oh, yes.
Rex had never done a musical before. He had never sung on stage before. But he was scared, and scared of an orchestra, and the orchestra drowning him out, and hearing things that he'd never heard before in the orchestra.
Get a woman in your life. Stop, 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 stop! Take it out. I demand that be taken out.
Take out what?
That yatta-tatta-tatta! It's so loud. How do I know where to sing?
He was quirky, selfish, charming, dashing, and brilliant. And I would learn so much just by standing on stage and watching him, however mad one got at him for the odd bit of selfishness. He cut the mustard every single night so brilliantly that you forgave him everything.
He actually had refused to go on and asked the management to put out an announcement that the revolve had stuck or there were some kind of technical problems, and which they did, and then they were about to do, and then the theater owner came forward and said, if you do that, I'll tell the truth. He's just chicken, he should go now. So they forced him on, and he was in incredible discomfort.
Ye God!
From an average man am I.
An average man am I, of no eccentric will, who likes to live his life free of strife, doing whatever he thinks is best for him. I'm just an ordinary man.
I was in a play called No Time for Sergeants, and our theaters backed each other. I would just go back and stand in the wings, and I was ever astonished at the stamina of all those people, but Julie most particularly.
I don't think anybody since Julie has played all performances a week. It's usually one performer for the evening performances and another one for matinees.
It's a huge piece because you have to scream like a cockney and you have to sing beautifully later on in the show.
I could have danced all night. I could have danced all night and still have been for more. I could have on a thousand feet, I've never done before.
When she came down the stairs, when she was ready to go to the ball, there was this beauty and this elegance. And just wait a minute, was this the one who did ow?
Hardest role to play. It needs tremendous irony, humor. She seemed to have all these elements that were necessary to make that character come to life in an effortless manner.
Sing me no song, read me no rhyme, don't waste my time, show me. Don't talk of tune, don't talk of form, don't talk at all, show me. But never do I ever want to hear another word.
It for a very long time, and really at times went through hell with it, because to do 8 performances a week with a show like that in those days, when there were no battery microphones that one wore, one literally picked sound up from like well-placed microphones on the stage, and the projection was enormous, and I did have vocal problems from time to time, and that's my greatest fear. So I think if I have worries about performing now, that's the only area. I think I have tons of energy, but I think every performer says, oh God, I don't want to disappoint an audience tonight. I want to be fresh and great.
Oh, baby, won't you play me the jazz hot, maybe, and don't ever let. Friend, it's really something to hear. I can't sit still when there's that rhythm near me. Oh, so maybe the jazz hot, maybe got hold in my soul together. morning or night. Only know it sounded right. So come on in and play me the jazz, hot baby, 'cause I love my jazz. Hot.
Special of Cinderella written by Rodgers and Hammerstein, which was a thrill. But when somebody foolishly just before we went on camera said, do you realize that more people will see this evening than could see my Fair Lady in a year, that sort of puts it in perspective for you. You could play to packed houses every night for a year and still it wouldn't be as many people as could see you on that one night live.
It was extraordinary to be around because it was essentially done as a live production, virtually as if it were a Broadway show. As I remember it, it was in black and white, but of course, in fact, it was really all built and painted, and the costumes were all in full color. A wonderful thing to be around and to be in the presence of Rodgers and Hammerstein, who were then very much the deans of the American musical theater.
In my own little corner, in my own little chair, I can be whatever I want to be. On the wheel of my fancy, I can fly anywhere, and the world will open its arms to me. I am in the royal palace of old places. I am chatting with the prince and king and queen, and the color of my two step sisters' faces is a queer sort of flower. When alone with the prince. Oh, la, your highness, you shouldn't say such things. I'm the belle of the ball, in my own little corner, all alone in my own chair.
Wildly excited crowd as the bride arrives. Julie Andrews, so well known to theater audiences on both sides of the Atlantic.
Our wedding was kind of a zoo. I certainly wasn't expecting it. Rex Harrison's son, Noel, my best man, was using his top hat to smash people aside to try and get us through into the church.
After the ceremony, Julie and Tony faced the difficult task of getting to the reception on time. So great is the throng. Soon they'd be waltzing away into their future. Here's happiness and good fortune to Tony and his fair lady.
I'm very nervous.
Have you ever acted with Richard Burton before?
No, never. I've never met him, as a matter of fact.
Is he going to do any singing in this Camelot?
I gather he is, and he's a Welshman. I should think he ought to be able to sing.
How do you think the story of King Arthur and his knights will adapt for a musical?
Well, I think it sounds fabulous.
Camelot was a wonderful experience because it was such a high-profile situation. It was the first Lerner and Lowe since My Fair Lady, and it's after the fact, it's very hard to explain that. But that sort of success that was enjoyed by, and deservedly by Lerner and Lowe and Mars Hart, it was so opulent.
When Camelot started out, Mars Hart said, it doesn't have to be like it was in My Fair Lady. It doesn't have to be as backbreaking and miserable. We're all successful now. It can be a glorious experience. And so I brought this champagne and we're all going to have a wonderful time. From that moment, everything went wrong. Adrian died. Fritz Lowe got a heart attack. And Alan had bleeding ulcers, I think. And Moss had a heart attack in Toronto. And on, until it was a riderless horse. There was nobody in charge of it. And it was Richard and Julie who kind of held it together. And their mutual love of the T.H. White book from which it derived.
And suddenly, for the first time, I felt I was king. I was glad to be king. And most astonishing of all, I wanted to be the wisest, most heroic, most splendid king who ever sat on any throne. You will come with me, my lady. I will arrange for a carriage to return you to your father. So, it's this way.
I hear it never rains till after sundown. By 8, the morning fog must disappear. In short, there's simply not a more congenial spot for happy ever aftering than here in Camelot.
Alan J. Lerner's right.
writing style was that it took him a long, long time to perfect his lyrics. And sometimes two lines would take any number of days. But apparently he worked in a tiny closet underneath his stairs because he needed to box himself in so that there was no other distraction at all.
I walked into the theater one day, and Alan, there was Julie up on the stage doing an entirely new thing. I think it was the Merry Month of May, I forget. But it was a whole number and new costume, and we were opening in 2 days. And I said to Alan, I said, but it's impossible. It's impossible to do it. And what if she can't do it? He said, oh, she will. And of course she did, and it looked like she'd been rehearsing it for months. Astonishing, astonishing professional.
What else do the simple folk do? They must have a system or two. They obviously outshine us at turning tears to mirth. Have tricks the Royal Highness is minus from birth. What then, I wonder, do they? To chase all the goblins away. They have some tribal sorcery you haven't mentioned yet. Oh, what do simple folk do to forget?
Often I am told they dance a fiery dance and whirl till they're completely uncontrolled. Soon the mind is blank and all are in a trance, a violent trance astounding to behold. And that's what simple folk do, so I'm told.
Was probably the most charismatic man I'd ever met. He was quite a flirt, and I have to confess that if he had wooed me at first, I probably would have succumbed just like anybody else would have.
What do the simple folk do to help them escape when they're blue?
They sit around and wonder what royal folk would do, and that's what simple folk do.
Oh, no, really?
I have it on the best authority. Yes, that's what simple folk do.
Later, Richard called me on the phone and he said, Time magazine says that you're the only leading lady I never slept with. And I said, well, don't tell them that, for God's sake. It'll make me more square than ever.
You're so am I there. You're so put her there, partner. And I'm so how'd you do?
Julie and I met when she came to see me in Once Upon a Mattress. And her manager said, I think you two can hit it off.
And I thought, oh, I don't know if I want to meet anybody new between a matinee and an evening show, but he persuaded us and we met and had supper.
Her manager never got a word in edgewise, and all we did was the chemistry, the synergy was there. People recognized that. And CBS gave us a special at Carnegie Hall. Did it as a live show. We were scared. All these people were coming into Carnegie Hall to see us. We did a whole takeoff on the Pratt family. We called it the Pratt family. And there were 47 sons, and Julie was the mama.
I'm Mama.
I'm Papa. I'm Satan. I'm Franz.
I had no idea that I would be asked to do the film. At the time, the show of Sound of Music was running on Broadway with Mary Martin in it.
I'm Cynthia.
You're the one.
confessed to my chum, Carol Burnett, that I thought I was pregnant. And she said, ooh, how exciting. Carol tells a story of at the end of one song, she whacks me in the stomach with her hand. And it's part of, I think, part of the joke. But after it was over, she thought, oh, my God, you know, Julie's pregnant. I hope it's okay. We have a beautiful daughter called Emma, and she's our pride and joy.
She was such a good kid, one of those children that sort of miraculously raised herself, and she was such a trooper with it all.
It's Julie Andrews, incomparable Broadway star of My Fair Lady and Camelot, now starring in her first motion picture as Mary Poppins.
I went to New York and I caught the performance of Camelot. Of course, I'd heard her records and things, but it was Camelot that I saw her in. And then I went backstage and I tried to talk her into the thing, and I tried to convince her I was capable of making a picture with live actors as well as cartoons.
I think Julie felt she wasn't made for the movies, and so she was kind of hesitant. So Walt was putting every lure in her path.
It was quite amazing because he literally, on having just viewed Camelot, just made up his mind that that's what he wanted.
I had just designed, a funny thing happened on the way to the Forum, which was also fortunately a big success on Broadway at the time. And so he said, and you know, when you can come and you can work on the designs.
He took me and Tony to Disneyland for the very first time. Now, if you can imagine going to Disneyland with Walt Disney, he stopped the show wherever he went. I mean, people gasped at sight of him. And he took us around in a little cart, and we got to the tree, this Swiss Family Robinson tree, and he said with great pride, he said, that tree has 3,605,000 leaves on it and 4,000,000 flowers and blah, 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 blah. And he paused, and then he said, and they say only God can make a tree.
And it was the first time that we saw just a little inkling of who he really was.
We discovered that he had several rooms filled with drawings of the way the film was going to be. It was completely laid out, all the penguin sequences and all the animated sequences and the live-action sequences as well.
I couldn't wait to see it on film because it started out with me as the chalk artist drawing on the sidewalk. And I start describing the wonderful scenes, then we all jump into it. And I couldn't imagine how they were going to do that. And then we were in this magical land, and we do, it's a jolly holiday. I start out with, ain't it a wonderful day? Bright as a morning in May.
I feel like I could fly.
Now, Bert, none of your larking about.
Although we had designed it to look like the very naive chalk drawings that Bert had done on the sidewalk, when it went back into the animation department, it kept sliding back to that sort of familiar Dumbo look. And it actually drove Disney almost crazy. And he would stay late at night or come in very early in the morning and go through trash baskets and pick up things that they'd been fearful had gone too far. And he would pin them back on the desk and say, go with this.
The shooting took a long time because of the many special effects in it. Lots of blue screen stuff where we heard no music or anything. The only thing we had was a beeping sound, which gave us the rhythms. You would never have known that she had never done a movie before. She seemed to know exactly where the camera was and exactly what she was doing, even though she had always been a theatrical performer.
You'd never think of pressing your advantage. Forbearance is the hallmark of your creed.
True.
A lady needn't fear when you are near. Your sweet gentility is crystal clear. Oh, it's a jolly holiday with you, Bert. A jolly, jolly holiday with you.
If you think about it, the songs in Poppins have a kind of vaudeville quality, and I instantly connected with them and thought, my gosh, that I can do that. I can really contribute to that.
He traveled all around the world, and everywhere he went, he'd use his word, and all would say, there goes a clever gent.
When Dukes and Royal Rogers pass a time of day with me, I say me special word, and then we off to tea.
Woo!
Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, even though the sound of it is something quite
After Mary Poppins, I was asked to do a film that was radically different. Disney was very generous, and he allowed Marty Ransohoff, who produced the Americanization of Emily, to come and see a tiny clip of Poppins. And how Ransohoff could tell from Mary Poppins dancing with penguins that I might be able to do the Americanization of Emily, I'll never know.
I can't marry you.
I've been waiting for that. We'll talk about it when I get back.
I don't want to talk about it when you get back. I don't want to see you again.
Emily, I will not be brushed off in a driving rain with my plane about to take off.
Oh, for pity's sake, Charlie. We both know it's finished. Now, let's end it in one snap before we say that we'll regret.
I know that it felt so different from Poppins that certainly one part of my brain said, well, that could only be good if you can pull it off.
It was significant then, it's significant now. It's an anti-war film. It was the first anti-war film during the Vietnamese War.
You're forever falling in love with men on their last nights of furlough. That's about the limit of your commitments. One night, a day, a month. You'd prefer lovers to husbands, hotels to homes. You'd rather grieve than live.
You're not only cowardly and selfish, you're remarkably cruel as well.
Come off it, Emily. The only immoral thing you have against me is I'm alive.
I'm gonna slap your face, Charlie.
Go ahead. I won't hit you back. I'm a coward.
They loved her in Mary Poppins, but they thought of her as a singer and all that. But this showed a different side of her.
I like your spirit, Commander.
I think I counted one time over 500 times we had to kiss during that picture of the rehearsals and all that. And what a pleasure. She's a great kisser.
What can I tell you? Jimmy was consummate at what he did and kissed divinely. And I thought, take after take after take, I thought, well, I can handle this. You know, we were lying on a bed and rolling around and... No, I'm going to be very professional about this, and it's not getting to me at all. And I got up off the bed and fell down. My knees buckled. And I hadn't realized that it had quite knocked me sideways, but it did.
You know, I've always said, when in doubt, hire the actress. And she's an actress. She's not just a singer and a pretty girl.
Star Julie Andrews and producer-director Robert Wise. They are on location in the Austrian Alps to film the Rodgers and Hammerstein musical, The Sound of Music.
She had done Mary Poppins. It was still in the cutting rooms, and nobody had seen it. But there was a little buzz around town that maybe she wasn't as photogenic as she might be. So we got permission to go over to the Disney studios one day and saw a couple of reels of the rough cut on Mary Poppins. The minute she came on the screen, we sort of, well, there's no problem, no question about that there. That's our girl.
Doe, a deer, a female deer. Ray, a drop of golden sun. Me, a name I call myself. Far,
we had seen Sound of Music on stage run. Together, and thought the role was perhaps not an ideal one for Julie. There wasn't a lot of spice in it. It was rather sentimental, and she had already just played a governess.
It was hard to know then what I recognize now, which is that it was the most extraordinary opportunity anybody could have.
Girls in white dresses with blue satin sashes, snowflakes that stay on my nose and eyelashes, silver white winters that smell of spring. These are a few of my favorite things.
There was a danger that we could become hideously sweet and sugary because we had religion and children and Austria and the Alps and music and things like that. And so we all tried in our own way to give it more of an astringent quality.
Fräulein, were you this much trouble at the Abbey?
Oh, much more, sir.
Mm.
I think Chris's contribution particularly rooted the film.
Excuse me, sir, I don't know your signal.
You may call me Captain.
I was so pleased as we got into the film that she just had such a range of emotions and talent that far, far beyond what I really had somehow expected. I don't know what I expected because she'd been such a star on the stage, but there wasn't any moment in the film in terms of her character that she didn't come up with in spades.
I was frightened.
Frightened? Were they unkind to you?
Oh, no.
Bob was very patient with me. He taught me a lot about filmmaking. Taught me how to be still on camera. Also was a wonderfully calming influence.
We thought that the song that the Captain Maria sang in the little pagoda at the end where the professor left was really not a particularly strong song. It was called An Ordinary Couple. We just felt we should get a better one than that, but we had to get Richard Rodgers okay, and he agreed completely. He said, it is kind of an ordinary song. I think I can get you something better.
Richard Rodgers wrote the lyrics and the music for Something Good. Oscar had passed away by then. It is such a pretty song, and it's done in such a beautiful setting in the film.
I must have done something.
The whole film is superbly crafted in every way. The sets, the costumes, the scenery, the way it was shot. It is magical.
The hills are alive with the sound of music, with songs they have sung for a thousand years. The hills fill my heart with the sound of music.
Poppins was the first film I ever made, and then came the Americanization of Emily, and then along came The Sound of Music, and all three movies had been made, but not released, and so I had this wonderful time playing at making movies without any of the responsibility or consequences.
We went to The Sound of Music premiere together. To be with her was overwhelming because everybody reacted to her like she was part of their family. They owned her. And so everywhere you went, it was one of those things that you read about and you can't believe is going to happen.
This is the night that Hollywood holds the world's spotlight. The annual Academy Awards and the bestowing of the coveted Oscars has a glittering audience on hand to hear Audrey Hepburn announce the best actor.
Rex
Harrison, of course, receives his statuette for his role of Professor Higgins in My Fair Lady, chosen as the best picture of the year. Audrey was his leading lady.
I think one thing that really upset a lot of us, who'd known Julie since she was a child, and that was Julie not getting My Fair Lady, the film.
While we were visiting her principal agent, there was an explosion, and several other younger agents burst into the room, yelling, "We did it! We did it! We got the part for Audrey!" And it was their moment of discovering that indeed Audrey Hepburn was going to be playing the role. They had no idea that this was Julie sitting in the room. It was a truly macabre moment.
I did really understand an awful lot of why I didn't get it. And Poppins came along so fast after that that it was more than wonderful compensation for losing it. It's only in later years that I thought, oh, I wish I'd put that role down definitively.
Julie Andrews and
Julie Andrews played opposite Rex Harrison in the stage version of My Fair Lady. Passed over for the movie role, she played Mary Poppins and parlayed the part of that bouncy governess into tonight's triumph.
Oh, this is lovely. I know you Americans are famous for your hospitality, but this is really ridiculous.
That sort of fame requires that one has the guts to overcome it, because it can be deadening when you are suddenly lionized and departmentalized. Because everybody's saying, well, no, you must do this. No, you can't do this. That would hurt your public image. And she would come to the beach with Emma, and people would come up to the beach with Mary Poppins dolls, and it was like, life for her was like being on a personal appearance.
She was the lovable, good-hearted, extremely welcoming person that everybody wanted to take into their arms and hug because she was so wonderful, as opposed to the crassness we see around us in everyday life.
It was a kind of Hollywood perception that if you could get Julie, you could get the earth. So agents and lawyers and managers and producers were desperate to tap into this seemingly magic touch.
I'm not a scientist, I'm a teacher.
You're a scientist, and you're supposed to respect a natural order in all things. Breakfast comes before lunch? Ow! And marriage should come before a honeymoon cruise.
Jimmy, oh Jimmy, oh what joy.
Now James Michener's monumental novel, his beautiful, fierce vision of paradise, comes to life.
I'm not going to let you go a second time.
Andrew, don't! Wait, I'm expecting, I'm a child!
The scale of that kind of Hollywood success was compounded by the fact that the studio system was going through a tremendous change. And the films that she worked on were perceived at that time to have literally saved three studios.
And I thought that the body of work would eventually speak for itself, and I did a wonderful film called Hawaii with George Roy Hill, and I did the Hitchcock movie, and I did Millie and all sorts of things like that. But I hadn't realized, because who could, that a really major success does kind of bracket you. People, a huge success, people remember you always for the thing that was the biggest or the most successful. Think of Clark Gable and you think of Gone with the Wind. I guess that's sort of what it's all about.
The demands that somebody in that position puts on themselves as a result of the demands that all of the other Hollywood types are putting on her are just out of the question. You can't deal with that at all.
I was so busy doing and absorbing and having considerable success just hit me that I think, A, it knocked me sideways a little bit, because you can imagine there was a great deal of an assault by press and publicity and things like that. But secondly, I didn't have much time to get perspective on it all, not until much, much later.
At a time when I think she probably needed a lot more support than I was able to give her. I was off trying to maintain my own professional life, and I don't know how you solve that when the success of the scale of what happened to Julie happened. It always puts people in that position, and those associated with them through some pretty horrendous situations, and we didn't survive that.
I can only say that we're friends to this day, and we know so much about each other because we go back so far that there's no need for pretense or stupidity. The fact that we didn't stay married is sad, but we've made our peace with it, and we've just stayed very, very good friends.
Crazy world, full of crazy contradictions, like a child. First you drive me wild, and then you win my heart with your wicked art. 1 minute tender, gentle, then temperamental as a summer storm. Just when I believe your heart's getting warmer, you're cold and you're cruel, and I, like a fool, try to coaster ride, but
know they say of Marie Antoinette, my reputation is a go-getter. So when I met Louis XVI of Bourbon, 'twas so disturbing, I thought a bourbon once in every while would keep me smiling. Louis says is King of France, not by chance that I wed him. They all do as Louis says. My, oh yes, I just bed him. Then I recline on my chaise. Who cares what they do? Who cares what Louis says? Louis says I misbehave, rant and rave, craving trouble. If he only knew the truth, in my youth it was double. My life's a big bowl of prez. Poor Louis Screwy, who cares what Louis says? Louis says I mustn't raise my voice. Louis says I haven't got a choice. Says I mustn't revel or rejoice. Says it ill befits the queen. If he knew what I got up to, you'd see Louis XVI go green. Spread. Louis says I mustn't lose my head, and the people haven't any bread. I say let them eat cake. Louis says that kind of attitude could be a grave mistake.
The wonderful thing about Julie's dancing, she can do it physically, but she does it with great spirit is what counts. There are a lot of people who are superb technicians, but you don't want to look at them because they have no personality. Her ebullience comes through when whatever she does.
When I shook my pelvic girdle, well, he did a double hurdle.
Your appendix?
Just tremendous.
Cerebellum?
Simply swell him. He loved my sinuses and spleen and every organ in between.
And yet he never said he loved.
A vague movement has no effect on stage. It must be precise. Her hands, as she places them, as she sings it, is exactly right. It looks like simple movements. People say, I can do that. You say, okay, let's see you try it. And it doesn't come across because the lyrics don't register. The song doesn't register. The point is not made unless it's done with great precision and a great sense of performance and humor.
During The Boyfriend, I met Michael for the first time. My crazy friend Dillis Lay brought him home to our apartment for a party one night or something like that. And I instantly, along with everybody else in the room, fell in love with Michael Kidd. He opened up a world of fun for me that I'd never known before. For instance, in the Big Jenny number in Star, he made me do acrobatic stuff that I never dreamed I'd be able to do. After about 10 or 15 takes, my back, my stomach, everything was just killing me. And finally, Michael was pushing and pushing for something that I wasn't doing. And I finally said, Michael, I cannot do it the way you want me to. And his face fell. And he said, you know, I wasn't criticizing. I really wasn't. He said, I just know that if you saw that on film, you would be less than pleased with yourself. And I want you to be pleased. And I suddenly thought, oh, I never thought about it that way. And of course, he was absolutely right. He wanted me to be the best that he thought I could be.
Jenny made her mind up when she was 12 that into foreign languages she would delve. But at 17 to Vasa, it was quite a blow that in 27 languages she couldn't say no. Poor Jenny, bright as a penny, her equal would be hard to find. To Jenny I'm beholden, her heart was big and golden, but she would make up her mind.
It was so disappointing. We opened in London, and Sound of Music had played the Dominion Theater in London for 4 years. And I'll never forget the first review I read on Star when it came out and said, well, I guess there goes the Dominion Theater again to Julie Andrews for 4 years. You know, it was just a marvelous review. But somehow, it just didn't catch on with the audience.
I think they were ready to receive the image of Julie as the self-centered, bitchy Gertrude Lawrence. It was just too contrary to everybody's feelings about Julie. I think it offended them. They didn't want to see her in that light.
He's my lover, my friend. What more could I ask him to be?
I met Julie in a wonderfully kind of Hollywood movie story kind of way. It started in the morning with me going into Beverly Hills, she coming out of Beverly Hills, and we would stop in the middle lane on Sunset waiting for traffic and then go on. And it you know, two or three times, and I kept looking over, and you know, three, four mornings a week there she would be. So eventually I said hi and she said, hi, are you going where I think you are, where I've just been? And I said, well, I don't know about you, but I'm going to my analyst. And she said, well, I've just been to mine. So it was all kind of meant to be.
Beck's one of the bravest writers I know. He seems to absorb every experience he has. And whether it's detrimental to him or not, he just pours it out and lets it show in all his movies.
I am a tremendous fan of Blake Edwards' work. He's made so many films that are just, they're just terrific.
I'll give you three guesses who loves you, who's loved you right from the start.
And their work together I love. I think Darling Lily, if it had come in another time in her career, it would have had a much better acceptance. It's a very good film. It's adorable.
I felt relatively soon after meeting and getting to know her that there was a great untapped quality in her.
Oh, no, there's somebody.
She'd been really pigeonholed. She'd really been stuck in Mary Poppins and Maria von Trapp, and that's terrific for those films, but I just knew there was more to it.
It's amazing that we stuck together because it was a huge flop, a terrible flop, and it cost a great deal.
I think it had a lot to do with the times were just changing so fast.
Often I think my poor old heart has given up for good. And then
with all great successes, there comes a period after a while when it just becomes the mode to not want to like that person as much. Somehow people, for whatever reasons one can figure out, people have not allowed her to change, to find another dimension.
I've never known Julia be a quitter. It's not like her character. She may be disappointed at some point, but then she's ready to go right back to work again. That's her early training. They played some terrible towns on that vaudeville circuit that she was in. She didn't quit it for that reason. She went right on and they played the next town.
Tell me, dear, what have you been doing with yourself all these years?
I'm on television a lot.
Oh, what a shame. Since I'm an entertainer, why not? Why not do film and television and record albums? And the thrill for me is to just kind of mix the whole pot up and try many different things.
Hug him in the morning, kiss him every night, give him plenty love
while we're alone and blue as can be. Dream a little dream of me.
The television series, that was hard work. I thought it would be about 70% hard work and I could be home for 30%. It was about 97.3, if you wanted to work out percentages. Happily, we won a lot of Emmys, but we were cancelled in the first year.
It's the end of the show, and it's time for me to sing one of my songs.
That's fine if I can do my bird calls.
Okay, go ahead.
It's time now to go. Everything must end. I'll see you soon, I know. Knowing time.
Sensation.
My friend.
Good night, Henry Bird.
It was just after my television series, and Blake had a series of very unhappy relationships with studios that had really butchered a couple of his movies and treated him pretty badly.
It was a terrible situation with MGM and the film that I did that I considered to be really very important to me and my statement. And then it was just too much. I couldn't handle Hollywood, if you want to call it that, although I'm not sure what the hell Hollywood is.
My career was on a kind of hold. We had a family, and we had a very, very pretty house in Switzerland that was sort of beckoning.
She just said, I've had it. And I'd never heard that come out of her before. You know, I can't handle it anymore. She said, I want to go to Switzerland. I want to live in Switzerland. I want to get away from all of this madness.
I said, why don't we do it sooner than later, Blake? I think it may be the answer for us all. Let's all go and just hold the family tight and be a family.
And we lived there for a while. We both had children of our own, and we adopted a couple of kids. And she kind of restored her soul, I guess. And mine likewise.
He did a lot of writing. He wrote his demons out. He wrote 10 and SOB. I think he wrote SOB first and 10 later. It took 10 years for SOB to get made. Every studio said they loved it, but then refused to touch it.
Suddenly, I did another picture. Lo and behold, I was back in Hollywood. And I went to a party shortly after it had come out and was a big hit, and they were all saying, I knew. I was the one that everybody else was saying, but I knew you'd come back. And everybody did that. It was just a joke. I loved it.
Night when it will become the greatest money-making film in motion picture history. Today, a $30 million flop. Tomorrow, a $40 million box office champion!
40.
A month's career rewrite!
Another 10 million.
Maybe 11, no more!
I'll tell you what you're gonna do, and I'll tell you what you can do. You're gonna recut Nightwind, and you're gonna cut it exactly the way I tell you to cut it.
Never!
Then, by God, if it's the last thing I do, I'll fix it so you never do another picture in this town as long as you live!
SOB changed very little, and at first it was kind of, my God, what is he writing here? I mean, the whole piece was so far out in those days and seemed a little horrifying.
No, no, no. There is no way in God's earth that I'm going to bear my heart out there on that stage. I thought I could.
You can, you can.
My mind says yes, but my body says no.
He certainly had me in mind when he wrote the piece, since it deals with my image and, you know, tilts at it and hilarious and stuff.
Sally will clear everybody off the soundstage.
It won't help.
It's just one shot. We will set the lights, turn the camera, everybody will leave.
No.
What about the guy in the jack-in-the-box?
We'll blindfold him. Nobody will see.
My public will see. My children will see.
I remember sitting in our jacuzzi with our oldest daughter, Jennifer, and Blake. And Blake said, you know what I'd really love to do? I'd love to make a really small movie. I'd like to put the whole family in it. I'd like to make it a sort of experiment. And 6 weeks later, we were beginning to shoot That's Life.
There was no script. What we had was about 80 or 90 pages in description of the story and the characters and their behavior that really was in depth.
I'm not going to go. I am not going to go out there and face those people. God.
Jack was phenomenal. You look into Jack's eyes and you get absolute feedback.
I bet you there isn't a person in this room who isn't absolutely terrified of their mortality. You better face something, my friend. You better face it. We are all going to die one day. Now, it seems to me you have three choices. You can take your own life. That's a stupid and vicious thing to do. And what kind of a legacy is that to leave your kids, hmm? Or you can look at what's right under your very nose, which is that you have three beautiful children who adore you. You have a wife who happens to think you're the best thing since chopped liver.
It's sort of a fascinating film for all of us, I think, to look at, because it certainly captures a kind of a dynamic of the family and a certain time in our lives.
Well, I wish I didn't have to feel this. I wish I could just turn the feeling off and not feel anything.
No, don't. Emotionally, I didn't have to do much in the way of substitution, because there was Mom, and I could, you know, cry on Mom's shoulder.
It's so short,
I was terribly grateful that she was there.
If you're not careful, the days go by, and all you have time for is regret.
About 10 years ago, when I did Victor Victoria for the film, I felt as I was writing it that this would make a terrific Broadway musical.
Victor Victoria is a wonderful gift. When you think that my good friends Henry Mancini and Leslie Bricus and my husband have written for me, I don't think any lady on Broadway would be that fortunate.
If anybody had asked me, pick one person that you know that will be the last to go, that is the Rock of Gibraltar, that would have been Hank. But he finished the score, and he did it bravely and brilliantly.
Sadly, Henry's no longer with us, and we miss him so much. But by the end of his creative part of the show, he was writing for character, and Blake is now completely into directing for the theater, and I feel like I'm back in harness again.
Monsieur Marchand, you are preoccupied with stereotypes. I think it's as simple as you're one kind of man, I'm another.
Huh? And what kind are you?
You know, Julie is someone who likes a lot of clarity. When we would discuss the character, because of all of the facets and everything, it would be terribly, terribly confusing to her. And she'd suddenly say, I didn't understand that. And that's good, because I hope that anybody seeing it has a little bit of trouble trying to deal with role-playing and all of the things that I tried to say in it.
The message really is, who are you and are you happy in your own skin? And if not, can you change? And if you can't, what are you going to do about it? There was a beautiful song written by Leslie Bricus and Frank Wildhorn called Living in the Shadows. And it really is about, it sums up the whole show, but it also sums up Victoria's feelings that she's been hiding for so long. And it's no good living in shadows. You've simply got to come out into the sunlight.
Living in the shadows, hiding from the sunlight, hiding from the one light that might help to guide you, hiding from tomorrow.
said to me, how could I have done anything else but be a part of this miraculous business that we're all in? She said, my father's the best designer on Broadway, my mother's performing, and my stepfather's the best director in Hollywood. How could I not be influenced?
There's so much pride for both of us in what Emma's been able to do here.
Yeah.
And Emma's role as artistic director has given her such extraordinary perception of theatrical skills and techniques that she's probably more valuable to Julie than anybody as a sounding board and an advisor while they go through this process of bringing Victor Victoria to Broadway.
It's wonderful that I'm able to show Emma a little bit of what it must have been like when I was in My Fair Lady. I mean, just to see me in theater.
It's something I've known about my whole life, but I was conceived during Camelot, so I missed the boyfriend, and I missed My Fair Lady, and I missed Camelot. I was completely unprepared to be so deeply moved.
I think for me the surprise is that I'm back at all, because for many, many years I thought I never would come back. In the old days, it used to be learning one's craft, maybe running away from oneself a little bit, and on a bad day, if you were a little blue or something, well, I've got the theater to go to. And these days, it's about, oh, what fun I can go and have a good time and make people feel great.
One thing I can tell you, life should be your lover, help you to discover your reason for being.
Stay tuned for Tony Bennett Live, next on Channel 17.